Okay. Hello, and thanks for the introduction. So, I'm Dimitris, and my talk will be about zero-knowledge proofs for set membership. It's a joint work together with Daniel Benaros from KEDID, Matteo Campanelli, and Dario Fiore from IMDEA Software Madrid. So, let's start first with some motivation. Why set membership? And the quick answer to this is the UTXO set. Now, let's explain a bit some things about it. So, say that we have a transaction, meaning that we have a spender that wants to spend her coin, and a validator that wants to verify the transaction. So, the list of the things that this validator should do is to check that indeed this coin has never been spent in the past. And for this, he uses the blockchain to derive the UTXO set, which is the set of all the unspent coins. And then, at the time of the transaction, he will just check that this coin is indeed part of the UTXO set. Something weird is happening. So yes, he will check that this coin is indeed part of the UTXO set. Now, this is not that satisfactory, and basically because first, the UTXO set is already fairly large, and second, it does not scale well, meaning that over the years, the UTXO set is constantly growing, and this is a scalability problem. So a solution that has been proposed is the use of cryptographic accumulators. And these are primitives that allow you to take a set, compress it to a small single digest, and in a way that you can also create membership witnesses for each element of the set. So now, the validator, instead of actually storing the whole UTXO set, he will have just to keep track of the very, very small accumulation digest that corresponds to the set. And the spender now is responsible for creating the membership witness of your coin and send it together with the transaction. So now the validator is taking this membership witness, verifying that this coin is indeed unspent, is part of the UTXO set, and he does it without having to search the whole UTXO set or store it. So, for this accumulator, the main properties that we require is first, everything should be public, meaning that each one of these processes, either to generate the digest, the membership witnesses, the verification, and so on, it should be public, it shouldn't require any secret key. And second, that this digest should be succinct, should be very, very small, much smaller than the actual UTXO set. Now, for the cryptographic property, the demand is binding, meaning that even if we have a malicious party that wants to prove membership for an element that is actually not part of the set, he will actually cannot. He will always fail to pass a verification test, the verification algorithm. So, after this, we can say that we can conclude that this binding property allows us to say that this accumulation digest is actually a binding commitment of the set. And thankfully, there are so many nice works in the cryptographic literature about cryptographic accumulators, starting from the famous Merkle trees that are widely used, RSA accumulators that are going to be the focus of this talk, and accumulators from pairings and lattices. So now let's move to the other property, zero knowledge. So zero knowledge has to do with privacy, and I will start with an example. So say now that we have a prover that instead of actually wanting to spend her coin, she just wants to prove possession of her coin to some verifier. And so this means that the verifier should ensure that, one, the prover has a coin that is part of the UTXO set, and two, that this coin, that the prover knows actually the secret key for this coin. But we want this process, this proof of possession, to be anonymous, meaning that we cannot allow the verifier to actually learn this coin or the secret key and so on. And this is where zero knowledge proofs come in. So the prover now is committing with a hiding cryptographic commitment to her coin, she sends it to the verifier, and she also computes a zero-knowledge proof, sends it to the verifier, and the verifier is just checking this proof and is ensured about the actual statement of the possession. And the key property of zero-knowledge proofs is that the verifier, from this proof, is convinced about the statement, but he cannot learn anything else, absolutely nothing else, except for the fact that the statement that the prover wants to prove holds. In this case, the possession of the coin. And this protects the privacy of the prover. So, in this work, we focus on zero-knowledge proofs for sent membership, meaning that we have an element, we commit to it, and we want to prove then membership of this element to some set. But the point is that set membership, in most of the use cases, or nearly always, does not go alone, meaning that we want to prove an extra property about this element, P of U. So we want to prove membership of this element for some set plus some additional property. And the thing is that this property is arbitrary and can be quite complex. So that's why we say that the zero-knowledge proof should be able to handle efficiently set membership plus an arbitrary statement. And the main goals are, one, succinctness, meaning that the proof should be very, very short, should be as short as it can get. Efficiency, regarding proving a verification time, and mainly, in this talk, I will focus on improving the proving time of set membership. And modularity. And modularity means that the set membership protocol should be able to compose well, efficiently, with other protocols. And where does this come from? So this motivation is from the Lego Snark approach. This is a recent work from Cavanelli, Fiore, and Querol. And the main idea in this work is that if you have a relation that you want to prove in zero knowledge, instead of using a single gadget, a single zero knowledge proof to prove it at once, instead decompose your statement, decompose your relation, and use small building blocks for the sub-statements. And then at the end, integrate these small proofs to a single one that proves your initial, the whole relation. And this integration is through the so-called commit and prove framework. And that is, if you have an element that you want to prove things about it, commit to it with a hiding commitment, and then use this commitment to prove properties with different protocols. So this commitment actually is going to be the linking between different protocols, between different zero-knowledge protocols. And in our case, one protocol is always the set membership, as we said, and the second is about an arbitrary statement. And the thing is that for the arbitrary statement, there are so many exciting works out there that are related to SNARKs that we do not want to lose, meaning that if you want to prove something, we would like to be able to use these nice SNARKs. We wouldn't like the set membership to prevent us from using all of these nice SNARKs. So now, the main approaches in set membership right now are, one, Merkle trees combined with zero-knowledge SNARKs, and two, RSA accumulators combined with Sigma protocols. And the first one is led by the famous Zcash protocol, and the second by the Zerocoin protocol. So the first one, although people from Zcash are doing an amazing job in optimizing the whole protocol, but still the main overhead of this protocol regarding the proving time is the set membership. This is quite inherent because verifying Merkle tree paths inside the SNARK is, with today's standard, quite inefficient. So the main burden in this approach is the set membership. Now for the second approach of the Zerocoin protocol, the set membership proof is highly efficient for the prover, although the main burden is that it does not compose well with zero-knowledge SNARKs. So our work basically is to combine the best of both worlds, meaning that we want the highly efficient set membership protocol and combine it with all of these nice state-of-the-art zero-knowledge SNARKs. And we want this composition to be efficient. And for this, we use RSA accumulators. So if I was to summarize, What's next? The rest of the talk will be about how to combine RSA accumulators with zero-knowledge NARCs. So now the technical part begins. First, I will explain a bit RSA accumulators and an existing zero-knowledge proof for set membership that uses RSA accumulators, then our results, plus some performance and comparison, and at the end, we will discuss a bit why our protocol can be a solution to the recent zero-coin implementation vulnerability that was found. So, RSA accumulators. As the name indicates, they are working over RSA groups. That means we want a modulus n, which is a product of two primes, a random generator from the group G, and this is our parameters. Then we start accumulating our set, and this set in RSA accumulator should absolutely be a set of primes. And this is somehow restrictive. We will come again in a few slides to discuss how we can overcome this. So you take your primes, you accumulate them, and the digest is just G to the product of all the primes. Then the witness for an element PI that you want to prove membership is G to the product of all the primes except for PI. And the verification is straightforward. It's just the witness to the PI should be equal to the accumulation digest. And if this exponentiation holds, then you ensure that PI is actually part of the accumulated set. So the main benefits from RSA accumulators that drew our attention is, one, everything is constant-sized, parameters, digest, witnesses, everything is constant. And second, and more interestingly, is that in a recent work from Bonnet, Bunce, and Fish, they showed that RSA accumulators actually can be used to build the so-called stateless blockchain, meaning that they provided a mechanism so that nobody in the network should store the UTXO set. And this comes from some nice updatability properties that they showed from about RSA accumulators. And thirdly, there already exists an efficient zero-knowledge proof that uses RSA accumulator and is for membership. And this is the Kamenes-Lysiaskaya protocol. So this protocol, which was actually our starting point, was part of our inspiration. So this protocol, what is doing great is that the zero-knowledge proof for set membership is highly efficient. It is very efficient for the prover. It also uses RSA accumulators that we want. But the main drawback that we wanted to overcome is that the commitment that we said is going to serve as a linking between different protocols, that is going to link our set membership with other protocols. So this commitment is in a fairly large prime order group, say at least 520 bits. And since today's standard elliptic curve groups are about 256 or 384, it gets quite inefficient to compose the Kamenes-Lysiaskaya with SNARKs. So I'm sorry the format is a bit weird. Okay. This is, I think, incompatible Windows with Linux, but okay. I mean, so the third thing is that the set itself that you're proving membership should be a set of quite large primes, say 260 bits. So our construction is using RSA accumulators, but for commitments in small elliptic curve groups, in standard ones, and for sets of arbitrary integers. And first, how we achieve arbitrary integers, since we said that RSA accumulators should only accumulate primes. And the idea is simple. You just take your arbitrary integers, you are using a hash to prime function to map your elements to primes, you get your primes, you accumulate them, and you have your final digest. And this final ACK value is actually a binding commitment of the initial set. And why? One, because accumulator is binding, and two, because the hash function is collision resistant. So we get a binding commitment of the set. Then the prover is using the accumulator to compute her witness. And we are done with the pre-processing. Now our protocol can begin. So our protocol is using two groups. An elliptic curve group, which is a standard one of standard size, and an RSA group. So the RSA group already has inside the accumulation digest, which is a public digest, a commitment to the set. And the first thing that the prover should do is to actually commit with a hiding commitment to her element. And this element is the element that is going to prove set membership. So this commitment is very important because, as we said, it's going to link this protocol, our set membership, with other protocols, with, say, snarks. Then she commits to the corresponding prime of this element and its witness, and she wants to prove the accumulation verification equation. And this is done by a root protocol in zero knowledge. This protocol is derived from Kamen-Lisiaskaya. So after this protocol, we are sure that P is actually part of the accumulated set. What we don't know yet is that this P is actually the hash of our committed element, of element U. And for this, we have to apply an extra protocol which proves a hash computation. And this is done in the elliptic curve group. So normally, we would be fine if everything was honest. Instead, when we go to soundness, the prover can be malicious. And that is, if the prover is malicious, he can actually put another commitment to the RSA group. So now we can have a commitment to P on the left and a commitment to P star on the right. And that's why we need to impose an extra protocol and a proof of equality that proves that actually the right and the left commitments are committing to the same element. So if we compose these three protocols that are all of them zero-knowledge protocols, we get a zero-knowledge protocol for set membership. We are proving that U actually is part of the set test. Now, this is not completely true, because I said proof of equality, while in fact it is proof of equality modulo Q, where Q is the order of the group. So what can happen with this is that actually a malicious prover can commit to an element P in the elliptic curve group, and then instead of committing to the corresponding P star in the RSA group, which is supposed to be the same element, he can commit to another P star prime, and as long as P equals P star prime modulo Q, he will pass the proof of equality and he will convince the verifier that everything is fine. So he can cheat the verifier. And this is what we call collision. So for our protocol to be sound, we need that P, okay, P equals P star is supposed to be this here. So we need that P equals P star over the integers. Now, after this, our work boils down to just eliminate the collisions of our protocol. And first, we need to analyze how and why are happening. So first observation is that this protocol, the root protocol that we said, that is proving the verification equation, is actually restricting this P star. So first thing that we are getting is that this P star can be at least a product of some primes from the set. And this comes from the security of the accumulator. And then if we impose an extra check to the root protocol, we can get actually an upper bound for this P star. So if we combine these two things, we are getting that P star can be a product of at most D primes from the set. And believing that this D is a small constant, like 2 or 3 or 5 or something like this. And it only depends on the parameters of our system. So our key idea was to fix the size of our primes, meaning that we have to fix the size of the output of the hash function. And then if we impose this restriction to the output of the hash, we get that the product of these primes that we said is now of discrete sizes, meaning mu, 2 times mu, and so on until d times mu. And as we said, d plus 1 times mu, which corresponds to d plus 1 product of D plus one primes, this is going to be rejected by the root protocol. So this slide is really not good. Okay. But either way, I want to say that in the paper, I don't want either way to analyze this slide, but I want to say that in the paper, we have two cases. We are proving that in case a nice inequality holds, and this is D times the size of the prime plus two less or equal than the size of the order of the prime group. So if this nice inequality holds, then no collisions can happen at all. Then in the case where this inequality does not hold, then collisions can happen with negligible probability if we impose some extra restrictions to the choice of the primes. So the thing is that this inequality depends on the parameters of our system. So if you can set your parameters so that the first inequality holds, then you are getting collisions with probability zero. If not, then still for some plausible sets of parameters, you can get collisions with negligible probability. And this concludes the soundness of our protocol. So in our paper, we have two more constructions. I don't have time, of course, to go through them, but I will say that the second construction is very similar to the first one. Instead now, the observation is that if you restrict your set to be a set of primes instead of arbitrary integers, you're getting a more efficient protocol. And this is because instead of a hash protocol, which is basically the main overhead for the prover, the hash protocol, so instead of a hash protocol, you only need a protocol that proves range. And this, if you, for example, if you instantiate it with bullet proofs, you are getting a very efficient protocol for the prover. And additionally, our primes now can be small, can be much smaller than 256 bits. They can be 32, 64, and this makes the whole accumulation procedure much more efficient. Now, for our third protocol, it works directly over elliptic curve groups, is of completely different spirit. It doesn't use RSA accumulators. And the main goal that we wanted to achieve is that the set now is also hiding, meaning that we have a commitment to the set that, except for binding, also hides the set. But this comes at the cost of having linear parameters. And now we are done with the technical stuff, and let's go back to the real world. So we have some estimations and some benchmarks for our protocol. I have to say we don't have yet a full implementation. So these are like, say, reasonable estimations. So the safe conclusions that we can make is that if we were to compare with generic SATU56 Merkle trees inside the SNARK, then our proving time would massively improve, say 40 times for large Merkle trees and 20 times for smaller ones of depth 30, for example. Of course, the proof size and the verification time cannot compete to growth 16. This we knew from the beginning, but still they are reasonable. Namely, the proof size is about 3.6 kilobytes, and the verification time would be about something less than 250 milliseconds. So this is like a trade-off. If you want to have much better proving time with the cost of the proof sizes and verification time, but still we wanted to achieve reasonable levels. Now, if we were to compare to the most optimized, to the really most optimized protocol, which is the Zcash protocol, after the sampling update and so on, and this is Pedersen hashes for Merkle trees over Jab-Jab curves, with growth 16 and so on, still we would get better proving time of about 2.5 times. And something that I'm not mentioning in this slide because we don't have benchmarks yet, but from theory we know that the RAM consumption of our protocol would be at least 4 times better. Finally, I want to refer a bit to the recent zero coin implementation vulnerability and why our protocol can serve as a solution to it. So about 6 months ago, Zcoin people found a vulnerability to the implementation of Zerocoin. And actually, this is a vulnerability to the implementation and not to the original paper of Zerocoin, I have to say. So in this implementation, a proof of equality is involved. And the problem with this proof of equality was that it had collisions. And these collisions, in terms of cryptocurrencies, are double spendings. So, of course, all of the protocols that used to use Zerocoin have abandoned it. Zcoin has already successfully moved to Sigma, to their protocol, and is moving further to Lelantus, and so on. So the thing is that even before this security leak, people were thinking of moving out of Zerocoin, and one of the burdens of the Zerocoin proof was the proof size, which was about 25 kilobytes. And our estimations after this attack are showing that a secure implementation of Zerocoin would be about 45 kilobytes, and this is like a conservative estimation. So in our approach, the proof size is only about 3.6 kilobytes. Of course, it's secure, as we proved. And the main thing is that the reason that I'm claiming that our protocol is easy to plug in in the Zerocoin environment is that they are both using pretty much the same pre-processing, meaning that we also have RSA accumulators as in Zerocoin. The only thing that one should modify comparing to the Zerocoin, if someone was to use our protocol, is the way that the coins are generated. So in our case, the coins should be generated with a hash function, while in Zerocoin, they are generated with a Pedersen hash. I'm sorry, with a Pedersen commitment. So if you apply this small modification, you are getting an easy, fast, and secure solution to the recent Zerocoin leak. And pretty much that's it. Now for future work, our first priority, of course, is to fully implement our system. And the most interesting research question is how to extend our zero-knowledge proof for batch membership, how to improve its efficiency by saying, say, for example, find a more efficient root protocol, which is the main overhead in our protocol, and in general, we are very interested in exploring zero-knowledge proofs with respect to other accumulators. And pretty much that's it. I don't know if I have, I guess I don't have time for questions. Yes, we had some troubles in the beginning. So if you have any question, I'll be around. Oh, okay, I have 2 minutes. So. Yes. That the prime is? You mean in the Zerocoin? Yes. Well, actually, the thing is that the hash itself is proving a range. I mean, by proving the hash, since we have fixed our hash to be of specific range, the output is of specific range. Where is it? Yes, since the output is of specific range, if you are proving that it is output of the hash, then you already have a range proof. But it's more, for sure, it's more inefficient than using bulletproofs for range. A hash computation is not inside the zero knowledge proof. I don't know. Any other question, maybe? Is what is it?
Where zero knowledge proof is applicable. My point is the typical blockchain with fixed membership uses deterministic consensus.
Is a bit irrelevant to what? I'm sorry, I didn't. If you're saying fixed membership, I mean,
it could be used.
In anonymous transaction, for example, what? Why isn't this a blockchain? Yeah, I'm sorry. Either way, I want to say that our work is for set membership in general. It doesn't apply only to blockchain. I mean, there are other use cases that I didn't include that are, for example, this. There is one example of know your customer. There are some whitelists. There are some examples of set membership, of applications for set membership that are not related either way to the blockchain. But if you want to discuss about blockchain, we are. Yeah. So that's it. Thank you.